What's up, guys? On today's episode, we are joined by the best hair in the biz, JD Pickell from On3. He tells us his thoughts on South Carolina in 2024. We also break down the depth chart Shane Beamer and company released. Locked On Gamecocks starts right now.
You are Locked On Gamecocks, your daily podcast on the South Carolina Gamecocks, part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Your team every day.
What's up, guys? Welcome in. I am Chris Marler, and welcome into Locked On Gamecocks. I hope everyone's having a phenomenal Wednesday or Thursday or Friday, whenever you're listening to the show. Hopefully not later than that, because we will be breaking down week one. But thank you for joining us and making Locked On Gamecocks your first listen each and every day. Shout out to our everydayers. We are free and available wherever you get your podcasts, as well as on YouTube. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. All right, today's episode is brought to you by our good friends at Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use the code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply, but download the Game Time app today. What time is it? It is game time. And it is game time for a fun midweek show. We are going to be joined by multiple guests, I believe. I don't know, to be honest, who the last segment's going to be, because I'm in a rainy Fort Lauderdale trying to get out of here and get back to Atlanta, but that will have to wait, because we are joined by a very special guest, JD Pickell from On3 Sports. He is going to talk about his most positive, hopefully, thoughts on South Carolina this season, as well as Shane Beamer and Lenora Sellers. We will get to that interview right now with JD. All right, we're joined by the best hair in the biz. Listen, when I first saw you, JD, I was like, all right, great hair. I feel like I've told you this before, and if I didn't, we're gonna address it now. But I was like, he kind of looks like the nicest version of an 80s villain. Like, you have a very, very real, like, Cobra Kai look to you, but you're like the nicest dude in the game, and I can't say thank you enough for coming on, man. How you been?
Dude, I'm doing better now. Like, that's a tough one to live up to now. I mean, that's high praise. So I'm hoping the South Carolina faithful feel that way about me after this segment. Not that I have anything planned to say that's like extra, like, controversial, but I mean, I just know it's week one. Tensions are high for everybody. So, man, I'm fired up to be on with you. This is a blast, and stoked to talk some Gamecocks here.
Yeah, man. So let me just get right into it. So we talked with Pate, we talked with a couple other guys, and just, I try my best not to be a super sunshine pumper for South Carolina, but I do just think there's so much to like about this year's team. And I tell you what, if you're going into the season, you're like, listen, they're going to win 9 games. I'd be like, no, they're not. Like, I don't know if that's where the ceiling should be. They could, but like, where the ceiling or where the floor has been set for this team and the expectations nationally, I say it over and over and over again on the show, it's so beyond low that I think it's like, you know, Vegas at the line at 5.5. Everyone I've seen this has them at 4 or 5 wins. What do you think is realistic this year in terms of a ceiling for South Carolina?
I think being in that 7-win range is realistic in terms of like the ceiling. Maybe not the ceiling, but that's like right in the spot where you say, okay, that's a good year. Like that's nothing to scoff at. That puts us in a position where like you can get excited about the future and Lenora Sellers. If you win 7 games, you're probably saying good things about him as first year starting quarterback. And here's the thing too, Chris, like outside of last year, Shane Beamer has like made his bed in South Carolina by overachieving. Like Vegas was wrong on South Carolina the previous 2 years before last year. And then last year, I think in some ways, like they were maybe a victim a little bit of how they finished the season prior with back-to-back top 10 wins. So like it kind of distorted.
Yes.
Discombobulated everyone's like opinion of South Carolina. Yeah. And so like we're hearing all these things like this offseason, obviously there's always a hot seat talking point, like who's on it. And everyone's like, Shane Beamer, they didn't do that great last year. I'm like, what are we talking about?
Right.
The dude just overachieved the previous 2 years. They don't go compete for a college football playoff spot the year after. And we're ready to like talk about the hot seat. So I think overachieving, being in that 7-win range probably puts you in a place where you're like, okay, I can live with that.
Yeah. You know, one of the best quotes I heard in defiance of like the preseason expectations, I remember it was our buddy Chris Doering And he told me this while he was wearing a shirt. So it was very, very rare air for him. He was actually shirt on, not shirtless.
Okay.
Very rare for Doering. But I remember we were talking about Florida, and what he said about Florida a couple of years ago, it's like 2021 or something like that, or maybe 2020. I think it's 2021. And it applies, I think, to this year's South Carolina teams. I remember saying, like, hey, listen, you guys aren't going to be able to do this. You're not going to be able to do this going into that season. And he was like, but here's the thing, man. Like, no one knew who Kyle Trask was a year ago. No one thought they were going to be any good for this a year ago. And they ended up going, you know, like 8+ wins, and they were a top 10 team. Like, I'm not saying that South Carolina could be a top 10 team necessarily, but like, it's like at this point, every single year you hear the same sort of disrespect, I think. So it's like, if you didn't think we were going to be good then, like, well, you know, why would we be super concerned about now? I do want to go and piggyback off of what you said about Lenore Sellers and to follow up with that, because he was finally named the starter, right? Like late last week. I think he has the ability, like, regardless if he's a 65% completion percentage passer, 3,000 yards, or like runs for 1,000, any of that, Lenore Sellers has the ability to like go up and get somebody like in a day. He has the ability to go take over a game, I think, and be that kind of athletic, you know, thorn in your side. Like, what do you think the ceiling is for Lenore Sellers? And what do you think we can expect out of him for the entire year?
Yeah, I think what you just said is right on the money. Like, in terms of just physical giftings, like, God gave Lenore Sellers a lot of things he didn't give other quarterbacks. And that's not to speak down on a Spencer Rattler or previous quarterbacks that have been at South Carolina, but I think, like, the ceiling for him should be enormously exciting if you're a Gamecock fan, right, for all the reasons we just mentioned. So I think if we're going to put it in a metaphorical sense, like, the piece of clay that Lenore Sellers is, there's a lot to work with there. So there's also questions around, okay, well, how much help does he have around him? How much does he need to, you know, kind of elevate on any given day to give South Carolina a chance? That's probably the next question we have to ask. But in terms of, again, just raw talent and raw ability, like, there's a lot to be excited about. And I mean, we've seen too, like, if you have a quarterback in college football, you have a chance any given year. Like, you look back to a couple of years ago when Utah came to the Swamp and played Florida, not to really, you know, make this a Florida-themed South Carolina show, but I think about that game where it's like Utah was, I mean, based on how that season went, the better team. They were probably the more established team. They had a better roster. And then that day it was just like, yes, they were at home in the Swamp, but like, AR was just that guy. So I'm not saying AR needs to be Lenore Sellers, but I think there's that potential with him with that skill set.
No, I completely agree with that. I really do. And you know, they don't open with a team like Utah. They get ODU, thank goodness. But I think it's the other thing too, is one of the things, there you go. I think one of the things that's so funny about this team that no one talks about is, I look at a team like Tennessee, and I tell you what, I'm probably going to regret looking at the comments after this, because I have made it a thing, apparently, in this episode where I'm going to talk about all their past division rivals.
Sure.
But like, Tennessee is a team that everyone's super high on. They're high on them because of a quarterback that has started one game. Very small sample size. They're high on them because they got a bunch of new faces in that receiver room and all that kind of stuff. And the other part is they've got some skill guys that are really good at the important positions, the defensive end, the edge rushing position, right? That you could make the case that might be the best position unit that South Carolina has, and no one's talking about it. So I think that's another thing too, that where you see some of these guys that really elevate a team based off of like one specific area on the field, South Carolina has those guys.
Yeah, there's so many guys that you circle and you say, well, hey, if he ends up playing to his potential, like, how good could South Carolina be, and what kind of impact does that make on their win-loss total? Like, I know he's super young, but like, Nick Harbor, the guy could be running in the next Olympics. Like, that is not just something we're saying in a hyperbolic sense. Like, he's legitimately that kind of an athlete. So if he dials in and kind of refines at the wide receiver position, throw the football to him on a fade, and like, good things are probably happening. Dylan Stewart, I know he's a true freshman, but also the ability there, if he figures it out quickly in the SEC, what you just mentioned, that could change the game. So I think the potential of South Carolina, and we're using if a lot here, but it's before week one, so it is what it is. That should be exciting, and I think that is exciting.
Dude, I think me and you both get just so passionate and pumped about college football, and we're both so glad it's here. We're recording this on Wednesday. Season starts really tomorrow. Like there's like good games. Like, I can't wait to watch. I can't wait to just be unified across social media, which never happens, and hate watch Colorado. And then also have a part of me be like, good for Deion if they win. You know what I mean? It's bringing the world together, which is going to be great. I do think you brought up what in the world? Was it Nick Harbor? And he's not going to start a receiver, but that's a difference maker. And I know that you are like somebody that's been counting down the days and just like, cannot wait till this happens. Cannot wait to see, you know, here's Sandstorm. I can't wait to see, you know, Death Valley at Night. I can't wait. Like all these things that are college football, like great moments, college football. And then just to get up for game day, dude, like just how great would it be if Harbaugh runs back the first kick? Like if South Carolina wins the toss or they like, you know, even ODU doesn't they defer and then Harbaugh runs back the opening kick, that place will explode.
Oh my, I mean, it would be on fire. The place would be an absolute fire. To think about like for that commercial break where they pan away from the slow-mo of him doing something cool as he crosses the goal line. Probably, I mean, I hope he does like the DeAnthony Thomas lean through the finish line, you know, like kind of the track celebration. You're watching that slow-mo on replay. You go to commercial and you're like, he might win the Heisman. For that minute and a half commercial break, which is obviously way too long, however long it is, they just throw as many commercials as they can at you. For that, like 90 seconds, you're telling yourself so many stories. Mm-hmm. And if you're a South Carolina fan and that does happen, like lean into that, that is real. That's tangible. Lean into that kind of a moment. And yeah, I can't wait. That'd be incredible. That'd be incredible.
Last question I'll ask you, it's a little more loaded and less, it's still fun, but you're about as tapped into recruiting as anybody, especially working at On3, and you guys do such a great job over there, keeping up with everything. And just, you know, it never stops now. It just never stops now with recruiting. What kind of success do you think is still on the table for this year's class of South Carolina? It kind of slowed down after June. And then what kind of class, like I keep saying, like if he could be inside of 22 in the country, because I think there's a steady drop off after 22, just from what we've seen from teams around 2022. But like, I don't think they're ever going to get the same kind of bumper crop of athletes they had in like the early 2010s in the state of South Carolina. But where does Beamer realistically need to be if this program wants to take the next step?
I think if they can be top 20, you start talking about having a roster that maybe hasn't closed the gap on the rest of the SEC, but you're starting to assemble some pieces to where that becomes a lot more manageable. Maybe you're in a similar arena. We were talking before we got on the air here, Chris, like you're looking at the schedule, you're looking at the class rankings, and you're like, okay, if we get the win goggles on, like we get some marketable moments where let's say they get a big win over, insert whatever SEC power you want to there. And you can take that on the recruiting trail and say, hey, this is just the tip of the iceberg. We need you, Johnny Four-Star, to flip to us and we'll be in good shape. Like, I think that's kind of the storyline I'd like to see unfold in Columbia, South Carolina. Let's get some momentum on the field. Mm-hmm. Let's bottle that up. Let's push that in this class, try to flip some guys, climb up these rankings and close on some guys that are uncommitted and, you know, see where we stand on National Signing Day would be my approach.
Dude, I'll tell you just last thing on that is like, there's two teams that you're not favored to beat. I keep bringing up four games, and our audience is probably tired of me even harping on this because there's four games that I think that everyone in the country thinks they're going to lose: LSU, Ole Miss, A&M, and Mizzou. And the history against those teams is not great, but you get them all at home, and those teams have struggled mightily on the road. I think if you're talking about flipping recruits specifically, like if you're a recruit going to Mizzou and Como, and it's, you know, 40 degrees there in early October or late October, whatever, and you got all these like 11 o'clock kicks and whatever, or if you're going to Ole Miss even, and I think Ole Miss is great and Lane Kiffin's great, and they obviously have a great, you know, environment there and culture and whatnot. But if you're a four-star kid and you're coming here and you could probably play right away at South Carolina, like in specific positions, and you see Williams-Brice and you beat one of those teams, I mean, that's a hard no to be like, I want to go. Like, no offense to Drinkwitz, no offense to Mizzou. I think they've done a great job there. But if I'm looking at Como and I'm looking at actual Columbia, I'm like, I think I'm coming to South Carolina.
Oh, without question. Right. Without a doubt. And Missouri is kind of another team you can speak to and look at what they've done on the recruiting trail most recently. This time last year, we're like, is Eli Drinkwitz on the hot seat? Like, is he going to make it another year at Missouri? And they went out and won double-digit games and beat Ohio State in the Cotton Bowl. So, like, it's just, it's funny the difference we get from media days through the season to the next year. Like, the narrative can totally flip, and that obviously would be massive for them on the recruiting trail as well, you'd have to believe.
Yeah, man. Listen, I told you we were going to be 8 minutes. I also told you we were going to record like seven other times today. So I appreciate you being patient, sticking with me. It's finally here, brother. I know you're as excited as I am. I don't think that, you know, anyone doesn't know who you are, but tell everyone where they can find your stuff, and you do a great job over there at On3.
Man, one, the juice just keeps coming, so I appreciate that tremendously. If you want to watch our stuff, you type in The Hard Count with JD Pickell on podcast, or you go to the On3 YouTube channel, and you'll see my mug over there as well, and we do our own content on that platform as well. But appreciate you having me, man. We made it, huh? We made it.
We did. Absolutely, brother. All right, I'll talk to you soon.
Heck yeah. Appreciate it, Chris.
Always good to have JD on. Really appreciate him coming on and talking about big picture stuff. And you know, we're going to talk about a little bit more about not small picture, but game one picture stuff as well coming up in the show. But first, before we get into our next segment where we talk about the actual depth chart finally released from Shane Beamer and the coaching staff, I want to tell you about our good friends at Game Time and the Game Time app. You guys have heard me talk about them a bunch, but I'm going to do it again because I have to. That's how we get paid. So in the Game Time app, guys, it is your go-to source for ticketing and all things tickets, live events, blah, blah, blah. Whatever in between. I'm not talking about even just sports. You've got comedy, concerts, theater, whatever you want. Game Time app has it all, and they do it better than anyone else. They have 110% price match guarantee where they credit your account. If you find something cheaper, the deals actually get better the closer you get to actual game day or the time of the live event. They have all-in pricing up front. You guys have heard me rave about that a ton. The all-in pricing allows you to see exactly what your total cost is going to be before you make your final purchase. And they also have a view from your seats right off the bat so you can see exactly what you're getting into and where you're going before the game or event starts. Take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time. Download the Game Time app today, create an account, use the code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE for $20 off your first purchase. Again, terms apply, but create an account, redeem the code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE for $20 off. Download the Game Time app today. What time is it? It's game time, y'all, and it's about to be game time. As soon as we come back, we're going to talk about the depth chart before we get into a little ODU preview. Locked On Gamecocks continues next. All right, guys, weird day. And I know you guys don't really ever care about hearing about anything that I say that's personal. But it's just been a weird day. It's been a lot of stuff going on over here and trying to coordinate stuff before I leave town and go back to Atlanta. Good news is this. Listen, I haven't been home in Columbia in like 2 weeks, and I've heard nothing but bad things about the internet still there. So we're going to have internet. We're going to have shows. It's just going to be kind of like sparse and all over the day. But anyway, want to talk to you about, before we get into our next segment, another good friend of ours, a real good friend of mine in the past few years, and that's FanDuel. Make sure you're heading over to FanDuel.com. You've heard us talk about FanDuel before. It's America's number one sportsbook. We have a different offer for you. Now through September 22nd, all FanDuel customers can bet $5 and get a three-week free trial on NFL Sunday Ticket from YouTube and YouTube TV. Then, with a YouTube TV-based plan, you'll be able to watch every regular season game every Sunday afternoon, out of market, everything in between. All you need is a Google account and a current form of payment, and you can cancel anytime. Just visit FanDuel.com/lockedon to download America's number one sportsbook. All right. And last but not least, we're supposed to talk about the College Football Preview Show. There's a preview show coming out every week. I'm going to ad lib this one and we'll just go from there. I know you guys are tired of hearing it. So, here's the deal, guys. Tomorrow night, we're going to do this every single Tuesday, and then on Thursday, it'll actually come out for your ears to listen and eyes to watch, a weekly SEC preview show where we preview games on the weekend and all that kind of stuff with all the panelists from Locked On. So make sure you tune into that. It's on the Locked On 247 channel. So it is a ton of fun. We already recorded it, had a blast. So there you go. Also, I'm going to be doing a weekly show with our buddy Chris Gordy from Locked On SEC, previewing that. You're going to get that on Friday. It may be a bonus episode some weeks. It might just be the only episode some weeks. But either way, you're going to get a full SEC preview as well. Let's get into what you came here for, and that is South Carolina stuff. I know, like I said, I apologize. I know I've been all over the place. I will actually try to put in some timestamps here to help out. You guys are a great audience. And I also want to say one thing before we get into the depth chart. Last thing, I promise. You guys have been awesome in the comments and stuff on YouTube. And I just want to say again how much I really appreciate it. I know we had kind of a rough start. Spectrum didn't help, but I just want to say I really do appreciate all the kind words you guys have said in the comment section on YouTube, and also all the help as well. Now, speaking of help, one of our listeners, sent me this the other day, and I'm trying to pull his name up so I can get the actual name again, and I don't mess this up, to say thank you, because the depth chart has been released, and the moment the depth chart was released, I didn't even notice this until it was sent to me. And that was at the very bottom of it. This is from Luke RJ, sent me this. At the very bottom of it, they included a pronunciation guide. So, guys, we should be good the rest of the year. I'm pretty excited about that. Let's get into the actual depth chart itself. Now, Let's start with the offensive line. All right, we'll talk about the offense first. At left tackle, it says Josiah Thompson or Tree Babalade. But here's the thing. You've already heard Shane Beamer talk about on his Colin show that he said we're going to be starting a freshman at tackle. Josiah Thompson is going to be your starter. Then you got Kamar Bell at left guard, Rashawn Lee at center, Torricelli Simpkins or Trevon Ball at right guard. It'll most likely be Simpkins, and his name is listed first for those listening. And then at right tackle, Cason Henry, the kid I talked about before from Marietta, from Walton, football factory up there. Then you got it tight end. This was interesting to me. It has Josh Simon and Brady Hunt listed as your first two guys, but Michael Smith was included second. And I'm going to tell you guys right now, you just look at his size, 6'6", 255 as a freshman. That's just different. That's just different. It's going to be hard to keep him off the field. Quarterback, obviously, you got Lenore Sellers. Running back, maybe I should not have been shocked by this, but I was a little bit surprised. You had Raheem Sanders, obviously, Rocket Sanders as your first overall running back. Then you had Juju McDowell or Oscar Attaway. Now, maybe I'm just an idiot, and usually I am. I think a lot of people would agree with that. But Juju McDowell is a name that just has not been talked about that much, including by me, throughout spring camp. And I think I said it a couple episodes ago, it feels like it's because they already kind of know what they had with Juju McDowell. So the fact that he's listed there, I think it speaks volumes, because I don't know how many carries he's going to get per game, but he is going to be featured in this offense in some way. So love that. And then you got this. Then we're going into the receivers. And I thought Nick Harbor was going to be one of your receivers. Then you have a kid transfer out to Louisville, less than 10 days before the first game. And then they also kind of, you start seeing the projections that Harbor's not going to be a starter. And they come out with the actual list. Jared Brown listed as a sole starter ahead of Harbor. Jared Brown from Parkview High School in Lilburn, Georgia. Go Panthers. Then Vandravius Jacobs. And I feel like I should have buried the lead a little bit with that kid, because I am pumped about Vandravius Jacobs. He's become an internet meme sensation, by the way. Shout out Gamecock Will, who just is firing off a ton of them the other day, and they were all very, very funny. And then last but not least, and we're going to have to use our what do you call it, our pronunciation guide here, but listed first, this is one of those ones that has like four different names with an or next to it, but listed first, Gage Larvadan. Not Larvadane, not Laverdian. I think I've said all of those things. I have mixed up where that I and that R go in that name in every single possible spot you can get it. But Gage Larvadan is listed first. And then you have Mazio Bennett and Peyton Mangrum and Luke Doty. That's all a or situation. So what that means to me is I do believe that Gage is going to be the first player you see come in on the field at that position. And then everyone else will be in the rotation. And that's kind of what we expected. The only thing I think that really stands out to me, I think the offensive line, like, it's got to make you feel good. That feels like it's – I keep saying this. You got to find the right five guys to be in the mix. I don't know if this is the right five guys yet, but I will tell you that I do think that these five are probably your best bet to start the season in terms of talent and fit and the way they performed in the preseason or in fall camp. But the other thing is this too, you still hear Shane Beamer say this repeatedly, you feel good about eight guys that you can rotate in there. So, and you got a couple of those guys. I was honestly most surprised, maybe I shouldn't have been, about Torricelli Simpkins being an or. Like, he's going to start, right? He's a redshirt senior. He's going to be ahead of Trevon Ball, who's only a sophomore from the ATL. Shout out ATL. But I was a little bit surprised that he was listed as an or. And he wasn't listed as the backup center as well, but a lot of versatility there, a lot of versatility along that line in general. I love it. Now, on defense. All right, on defense, let's start with the secondary, because I think it's probably the most interesting and also where the most consistency probably was. Well, besides linebacker. Linebacker, you had Debo Williams, obviously, at the will and weak side linebacker. And then you have the other position you have for middle linebacker and Mike. You had Demetrius Knight Jr., who we talked about, listed – or Bam Martin Scott. Now, see, Bam Martin Scott's name was listed first, but Demetrius Knight Jr. also included on that. Do love that. And you talk about the defense. Again, you're talking about a defense that's going to be running a 3-3-5 or a 4-2-5. So in the secondary, you're going to be a nickel predominantly. You're probably going to have a little bit of dime as well, but you're going to be a nickel most of the time. I continue to say, I think 4-2-5 is where this defense should be. Everything I read – and people that are smarter than me and make more money to make those decisions on that coaching staff have said repeatedly it's going to be a 3-3-5. So I think you will see a mix of this flex nickel defense. I maintain that you should have the best success in 4-2-5, but whatever. Here are your five secondary starters. You had Jalen Kilgore at the nickel. O'Donnell Fortune, that's like the least surprising starter outside of Debo Williams, I think, on the entire roster, like just like flat out. And you had Nick Emenwori at free safety, DQ Smith at strong safety. And then at the other cornerback position, Judge Collier listed first ahead of Vakari Swain. I shouldn't be surprised by that. Vakari Swain, though, I thought was a guy that was going to see the field a little bit more to start the year. He's listed behind him. And then let's get to the defensive line. And this is just a position unit that I have failed to talk nearly enough about. I talked briefly about it with J.D. Bakel earlier. I think it could be your most, like your deepest and your most talented unit on the team. And I think one of the reasons we haven't really heard that much about it is because, like, not a lot of questions there, guys. Just not a lot of questions. I mean, the biggest question, I think, on the defensive line is, how far along is Dylan Stewart in his first year? Physically, he's 6'6", 248 listed on the depth chart. He's put on some size. He looks, if you've seen any of the pictures, we did a whole show or a whole segment on a show in the summer. Physically, the kid's ready. But he was listed as a basically third string off the edge. Now, he is behind, currently, he's behind Jatias Gear or Ryan Thomas Jr. So maybe it's technically second or third string, depending on how you look at it. But his name listed third. To be fair, he is listed behind two upperclassmen, a junior and a redshirt junior. So those two grown men. Then you talk about the defensive tackle position. You got Alex Huntley and Tonka Hemingway. Tonka Hemingway is listed as a or next to TJ Sanders. That is a deep and deep and very veteran experienced line. Right in the interior, arguably the most important place to stop the run, a place you struggled at a year ago. But your two defensive tackle positions, you've got three guys that are going to rotate, Huntley, Sanders, and Hemingway. And the two starters you have listed first are both seniors. One's a super senior. It's been there for 6 years. The other one's a fifth year. It's a redshirt senior. And then, oh, by the way, TJ Sanders, fourth-year junior. So you've got grown men, 22 to 24 years old, plug in the middle. Love to see that. Tonka Hemingway is a guy that I think by the end of the season, you might look up. And you honestly, you could make the case for Huntley too, and really even Sanders. But I think Tonka Hemingway is a guy at the end of the year. We're going to look up and at the end of this season say that guy was one of the most consistent and best interior defensive linemen in the SEC. And I also think that you're going to look up and see him drafted on day two of the NFL draft next year and think – or early day three and be like, God, that guy, the consistency and the production that kid put up while he was at South Carolina in his last two seasons, often overlooked. And then the other edge rush position, Kyle Kennard listed first, the transfer from Georgia Tech, and then Gilbert Edmond, guy went down to Florida State, came back. That is a or as well. All this tells me is this. You've got very, very good depth all across the defensive line. I do not think – I think the players that are going to get the most – what's the best way to put this? I think the most playing time and the most opportunity, obviously the ones that are going to be able to produce, right? Across the D-line, I don't know what Dylan Stewart's going to look like. I will venture to say that in game one, he does something because that defensive line should be in the backfield all day against a porous offensive line from Old Dominion. Moving forward, you know, you go to Kentucky the next week, you get LSU up for that. You know, it's not necessarily a super friendly schedule like Ole Miss or Mizzou have where you're like, you know, easing into the entire season by four cupcakes and then you go into conference play in October. South Carolina doesn't have the opportunity to do that. I think that getting those guys playing time early is going to be key, but I also think that the best players, it's like the cream always rises to the top, right? Kyle Kennard, Gilbert Edmond, I think are both really good. Kyle Kennard is a guy that I think is potentially going to be one of the best edge rushers, if not the best edge rusher on this team. So there is that. That is the depth chart. You also had this, and I kind of buried the lead here, but we talked about it earlier with JD. The only real surprise here, right? You didn't have Harbor listed as a starter at receiver. him and Juju McDowell are the two deep men, and he's listed as a kick returner. That's got some juice to it, as JD would say. That makes me feel things, and mainly goosebumps, because that kid can fly. And if he gets in the open field at some point this season, Nick Harbor is going to be a difference maker. And here's the thing again, guys, you know, I know he's not playing as a starter in per se at receiver, but you got to get your best players on the field, and special teams is like the calling card of Shane Beamer, right? Beamer ball. How big of an impact can that kid have? We'll see. We'll see. I think it could be pretty big. Juju McDowell listed as the punt returner. The other one is Gage Larvadan as well. No real surprise there. Kai Kroger is obviously is your punter. And then the other thing too was your kicker. There was a little bit of question surrounding this, like who's it going to be? You got to replace the kid from Jeter from last year. Alex Herrera wins the kicking job. He is a super senior, so he is in his sixth year. He's from Columbia, South Carolina. Love to see that. So he obviously it means something to him playing for the hometown team. And the other thing is too, 24-year-old. I'm not saying it helps to have a 24-year-old like he does at other positions, like, you know, offensive, defensive line, quarterback, whatever. But I love the fact that you have some experience there, at least in age. So that is your starting 11 on both sides of the ball, including your depth chart as well from Shane Beamer. Lots to be excited about. I think what I'm mostly excited about, besides some of the things I mentioned, the thing I'm most excited about is this pronunciation guy, because that's going to be a huge help for me. So that is all for segment two. We will finish the show here shortly after this. Before we do, I do want to give a quick shout out to our friends at 5-Hour Energy. You guys saw me the other day talk about this. 5-Hour Energy, it's a fantastic way to get a quick pick-me-up, whether you have to tackle a to-do list, you got to, you know, kill that 2:30 feeling, if you are trying to go get a workout in, whatever. Get in the zone, get a 5-Hour Energy shot, and it gives you the feeling of alertness and energy you need to get in the zone, like I said. So remember this, too. Right now, if you go to 5hourenergy.com, that is the number 5, and then hourenergy.com, you get some 5-Hour Energy product with a massive promo code. Use the promo code LOCKEDONCFB. You get 20% off your total order. And here's actually one thing. If anybody out there is like a caffeine and an energy junkie like I am, this offer is valid till September 30th, okay? So the end of next month. It cannot be used with any other promotions, but if you use the promo code, like I said, LOCKEDONCFB, you can go online and you can make your own custom 12 to 24 pack. Like there's like tropical burst is awesome. The watermelon is actually really, really good as well. There's a few of them that are really good. Not grape. I'm not a big fan of grape. I'll just be honest. It says it in the ad read, but just be real with you guys. It's the one I don't like, but that's okay, because there's like 50 different flavors and the rest of them are all great too. So find out what you do like. Maybe it is grape. Mix and match today. Go to 5hourenergy.com and make yours today. All right, that's all for today's show. I know I told you we were going to talk about ODU later. We are going to talk about them. I'm going to wait until tomorrow. Thursday, we'll do a full preview of them. I do want to talk about this situation with our linebacker where they have apparently been padding this guy's stats. He's like a 2-year All-American that has like 350-plus tackles in 2 years, which is outrageous, but it's a very funny story. We'll talk more about that tomorrow and preview the game itself. I did hint at this the other day, so I'll close with this. The Old Dominion line has dropped dramatically for some reason on ESPN Bet. It's down to 17.5, and it really hasn't. It's the only book that has this game at that line. And I have a take on as to why. And it's not groundbreaking, and it's not anything that's super concerning. I think it's because they don't know what they're doing since they just launched ESPN Bet last year. I think it's laziness or something is wrong. But I will encourage you to go look at the other lines. Go to our friends at FanDuel. You get it at 20.5. I don't know how long that's going to be up there, but this line did drop specifically on this one site. And then I started doing my research, and I'm looking around everywhere else, and the line's 20.5 to 21 everywhere else. What that tells me is, one, it feels like if one book even does have it 17.5, even if it's an oversight, it feels like South Carolina is going to win by more than 17.5. Now, are they going to cover that? I don't know. I think they will. I'm not going to get into my final score predictions until later in the week. But it also tells me that I think that the question that they have in this book specifically is, how many points is the offense going to be able to score? Because ODU should be good for 14 points. Can South Carolina score 34? I don't know. We will find out. I do think it's, like I said, though, I think it's an oversight. Because here's the thing. I think that what the rest of the country is going to find out pretty quickly, especially around the SEC, and Vegas will catch up to it at some point, is that this defense is not going to be giving up over 21 points a game a lot this year. They're just not. They're going to be very, very good. And like I said multiple times, they're going to feast this weekend on that offensive line. So that is all for today's episode. Make sure after you listen to Locked On Gamecocks, this is your first listen, make your second listen Locked On SEC or Locked On College Football, whichever one you want. But I'm going to say Locked On SEC today with our good friend Chris Gordy. Like I said earlier in the show, we've got a weekly segment we're going to be having coming up throughout the season with him where we preview all SEC games. It'll come out every Friday. And we will be previewing the South Carolina game as well. And we'll do our own show previewing that a little bit more in depth tomorrow. I promise. I know I've put it off. But appreciate you guys. Hope you have a great rest of your Wednesday. And we will talk to y'all tomorrow. Go Cox.